So remember, last time we dealt with two classes of exotic superconductors, or exotic by some kind of criterion. The first being the alkali fluorides. And you remember that really there doesn't seem to be very much that's exotic about the alkali fluorides, except that they have a rather high transition temperature. 40K is very high by the standards of pre-1975 superconductivity, but they're not even unique in that. Magnesium diboride also has something like 40K, and you could just almost as well throw that in the same group. So really, I think there's no particular reason to believe that the alkali fluorides are anything other than simply BCS superconductors, which happen to have a rather high transition temperature. The other class we looked at last time was the organics, and they do seem to be rather different. In particular, they're very strongly layered. They do have... there's one thing I guess I didn't mention explicitly. It's something we'll have to come back to. The organics are actually quite close to a... antiferromagnetic phase. That is, superconductivity does occur quite close to antiferromagnetism. However, to see that antiferromagnetic phase, what you have to do is not to vary the doping, which is what you do in most cases, but to vary the pressure. You do find in the pressure temperature diagram, you do have an antiferromagnetic phase fairly close by. So those are the two classes we looked at so far. Now let me go on to some other examples of exotic superconductivity. And the next one I want to consider is the heavy fermions. And these actually have quite a long history. They were the first class of exotic superconductors discovered experimentally way back in 1975. The so-called heavy fermion systems are a class of compounds which contain a rare earth element, which is usually cerium, or an actinide, which is usually uranium, but people have started playing around with plutonium. Needless to say, you have to be in a rather special place to deal with plutonium, and most of that this work is done at Los Alamos, a national lab in the US. And what's special about these compounds is that they have an electronic specific heat which exceeds the textbook value by something like 2 to 3 orders of magnitude. In other words, if you express the electronic specific heat, it looks like it's roughly linear in temperature, so you can take out the coefficient, express it in terms of an effective mass, and that effective mass is something like 100 to 1,000 times the bare electron mass, hence the name heavy fermions. Now, of course, it wasn't immediately obvious. These compounds were discovered, I guess, in the early 70s, and it wasn't immediately obvious that this interpretation of the electronic specific heat in the usual Fermi liquid terms was right. It could have been that this large specific heat was due to, for example, strongly localized or nearly localized electrons. But then it turns out that you do actually see these large effective masses in other experiments, for example, in de Haas van Alphen type experiments. Moreover, when the system becomes superconducting, as some of them, as we'll see, do, then a large part of this electronic specific heat is removed. So it does look as if it's associated with mobile electrons. Now, with one exception, rather interesting, actually two or three exceptions, but one of them is particularly interesting. The heavy fermions, generally speaking, are three-dimensional, not strongly layered. This is, as it were, an executive summary. The normal state of the heavy fermion systems is, generally speaking, very non-Fermi liquid-like. It's complicated, it's controversial. I think most people agree that at least some of the effects qualitatively come from the fact that typically in these rare earth or actinide compounds, you have a combination of nearly localized electrons which are interacting with a sea of conduction electrons. And it's, in one way or another, it's believed to be this interplay between the localized and mobile electrons, which give rise to many of the properties, but the details are really not terribly well agreed. As regards superconductivity, there are four classes of heavy fermion systems. First of all, there are the ones which show no phase transition whatever. These are sometimes called the vegetables. An example is cerium aluminum 3. But it is a fully paid up heavy fermion system. I think it has something like 1,000 times the free electron mass. There are some heavy fermions which have a magnetic transition only. An example is cerium copper 6. Some which have a superconducting transition only, and here's a list of some of these. And finally, there's an interesting class which have both magnetic and superconducting transitions. And as we'll see, the magnetism can be of various kinds. It can be antiferromagnetic, it can be ferromagnetic, in the case of uranium, germanium 2. So in this class of materials, you actually have a coexistence of magnetic order and superconductivity. And up to around 1975, I think, this would have been generally held by the theorists to be impossible. It was generally believed that there would be a strong antithesis, a strong conflict between magnetism and any kind of magnetic ordering and superconductivity. But that does appear to be the case in these compounds. Now, in almost all cases of superconductivity in a heavy fermion system, the Nail temperature for a transition, the magnetic transitions, can be the order of a few tens of Kelvin, but the superconducting transition temperature is almost always less than 2K. However, there's actually a very striking exception, which was discovered only in 2005, and that is plutonium cobalt gallium 5, which has a TC way up at 18.5K, nearly an order of magnitude greater than the other heavy fermion systems. Now, I think it's very unlikely that this is a single outlier. I strongly suspect that there are going to turn out eventually to be other plutonium compounds which also have this kind of high transition temperature. But as I say, for obvious reasons, plutonium is not the easiest element to do experiments on, and so progress is likely to be somewhat measured in that case. But the other interesting point about plutonium cobalt gallium 5 is that it does have, unlike most of the heavy fermions, it has a very strongly layered structure. In fact, you have plutonium gallium 3, cobalt gallium 2 sheets interspaced. There were two other heavy fermions like cerium cobalt indium 5, which are also somewhat layered, but not as strongly, apparently, as this guy. Now, what about diagnostics? Are the heavier fermion superconductors driven by the standard BCS electron phonon mechanism? Well, I think a rather strong argument against that is that as far as I know, there's no heavy fermion superconductor which shows any appreciable isotope effect. So that really rather strongly suggests that you've got a non-phonon and therefore automatically all electronic mechanism. So these then were the first examples of superconductors showed an all electronic mechanism of superconductivity. Incidentally, you might ask, would it be fair to class the heavy fermions as high temperature superconductors? Well, first sight, obviously not, since their transition temperature is way down around 2K. Again, as in the case of the organics, if you actually scale that to the effective Fermi temperature, remember, if you have, remember what happens in band theory. If you have a large effective mass, then that means you have a large density of states, which in turn means your band is very narrow. So your Fermi energy is scaled way down. And so in some sense you could say, it's not very clear what you really mean by the Fermi temperature or Fermi energy of something as strongly interacting as the heavy fermions, but insofar as you can define it, it is several orders of magnitude smaller than that of a typical a typical textbook metal. So in that sense, you could even claim that the heavy fermions are high-temperature superconductors. Yes.
What is the
isotope effect? Oh, okay. In classic superconductors, a very important discovery was made around 1950, namely that if you compared two compounds which were chemically identical but had different isotopes, for example, I think it was the original ones which compared with two different lead isotopes, then you find that the transition temperature appears to go inversely as the square root of the effective mass. Or if you could say equivalently, it scales with the Debye temperature of the solid. Now, the importance of that is that if you were to take any kind of model of superconductivity in which the ions were simply fixed and one could forget about their motion, then there's no way in which the isotopic mass could come in. And so, so the discovery of the isotope effect gave a large fillip to the idea that somehow ionic motion was involved in the mechanism of superconductivity. Okay, so now, as to the pairing state, you need to discuss each heavy fermion superconductor separately. And moreover, there is a further complication, which I haven't emphasized explicitly so far. Namely, generally speaking, we tend to classify the order parameter of superconductors in terms of the spin symmetry and the orbital symmetry separately. And that's fine, as long as there's no substantial interaction between the spin and orbital degrees of freedom. Alas, in the heavy fermions, particularly in the uranium compounds, there is likely to be a substantial interaction due to spin-orbit interaction. And once you have that, you can't really talk about spin singlet and spin triplet separately. You have to talk about, you have to classify them only in terms of the remaining invariances, which are parity and, crystal lattice symmetry, but also parity and time reversal. Now, as far as we know, there's no evidence that any of the heavy fermion superconductors break time reversal symmetry. We'll see later that there are other compounds which may, but the heavy fermions don't. So,
what is the signature of time reversal?
Well, the most obvious signature would be the development of some kind of spontaneous magnetic moment. And there's no evidence that anything that, like that happens. Or again, insofar as people have done experiments, I don't think there have been very many. There's no particular evidence, for example, for a Kerr effect, is the rotation of the optical polarization vector. So, so as far as we know, none of them violate time reversal symmetry. But as to parity, many of them may well be odd parity. So, crudely speaking, odd parity is somewhat like the case of spin in a non-superconductor where spin-orbital coupling is not important. It's like the case of spin triplet, where you have to have, therefore, odd orbital parity. So you, there are all sorts of diagnostics which people use of the symmetry of the order parameter. Most obvious ones are the low temperature behavior of various quantities, light specific heat, the electronic thermal conductivity, the nuclear spin relaxation time, the night shift, dot, dot, dot. Question of HC2, whether you see a Chandrasekhar-Clausen limit or not, the sensitivity to non-magnetic scattering, et cetera, et cetera. Various diagnostics, and it looks like they all come out rather differently. Here are some representative heavy fermion superconductors with the symmetries which people tend to guess at least about them. And you see that these are only a subset of the rather large class of heavy fermion superconductors, But you see that even within this class, some of them are always paramagnetic, some of them are antiferromagnetic, and at least one, uranium-germanium-2, is ferromagnetic, as well as being superconducting. TC, well, here's, you see, always of the order of 2K or below. Parity, well, again, not always easy to infer, but apparently both positive and negative. In particular, cerium cobalt indium 5 is thought fairly confidently to have the so-called dx squared minus y squared orbital symmetry. So as you see, basically they come in all shapes and sizes, the heavy fermions. Okay, so before I go on to the next class, any questions or comments about these? Okay, that's a slightly complicated question. I think what you're referring to is the way in which BCS pairing affects various experimental quantities, like, say, the nuclear spin relaxation time and the ultrasound absorption and so forth. So that is a rather messy question. What happens in a typical BCS, a classic superconductor, is roughly this. First of all, you always get when you go into the superconducting state, you always get a strong increase in the density of states close to the gap edge. So here's your density of states, and of course in the normal state it would just be as a function of energy relative to the Fermi energy. In the normal state, the density of states would just be flat, okay, constant. Now in the superconducting state, what happens is that if you put, say, minus delta here and delta here, delta, then you find a strong peak, and then of course the usual absence of any states below the gap, but above the gap you get this strong peak. Now by itself, generally speaking, if this were all the effect, what that would mean is that any quantity which is, as it were, sensitive to the nuclear spin relaxation time, which was sensitive to the density of states, would be expected it's not quite obvious what would happen if you have something which is simply proportional to the density of states itself, like the specific heat. In fact, you find there is actually a strong rise at TC. If you have something which is sensitive to the square of the density of states, like the nuclear spin relaxation time, then this effect alone ought to give you a strong increase as you go below TC. And then, as you go down to lower and lower temperatures, basically that goes away because there is no more normal component left at all. So naively then, you would expect that the nuclear spin relaxation time and also the ultrasound attenuation would rise strongly as you go below TC and then fall again. Now, in the case of the ultrasound attenuation, that's right. I just confused myself for a moment. Okay, so that would in fact that would give you a strong rise in both cases. Now, in fact, you see the rise in the nuclear spin relaxation. You don't see it in the ultrasound attenuation. And so the question is why, and the reason is that there's an extra factor that comes in BCS theory, which has to do with the coherence factors between creating quasar particles and creating quasar holes. And in the case of the ultrasound attenuation, that's such that it actually cancels the peak, whereas in the case of the nuclear spin, it's left there. This is the well-known so-called Hebel-Strichter peak. It's very it was discovered experimentally by my colleague Charlie Slichter and his student Chuck Hebel at Illinois at exactly the time when Bodine, Cooper and Schrieffer were evolving their theory, and it was generally taken as a very strong confirmation of their theory. It's very specific to it. I'm sorry, what was your question again?
In the exotic
superconductors? Interesting question. The question then is, do we expect Ginzburg-Landau theory or some other general phenomenological theory still to work for the exotic superconductors? And I think, crudely speaking, the answer is yes, but you have to make the appropriate adjustments. So the basic idea that you can write down some kind of order parameter and express, say, the electromagnetic behavior in terms of that we believe that should still work. However, you do have to bear in mind that the order parameter may have properties somewhat different from what it did in an old-fashioned BCS superconductor. In particular, it may be that it has some kind of internal structure that you, that's the point that I actually emphasized in the last lecture. You have some kind of internal structure of your Cooper pairs. Now, when you're trying to work out things like the electromagnetic response, it turns out that really doesn't matter all that much. And the reason it doesn't matter is that you do have this anisotropy of the order parameter in some cases. For example, if you had if you had cobalt, Cu and cobalt indium 5, and if indeed the order parameter is dx squared minus y squared, then it does have some kind of non-trivial internal structure. However, that internal structure is usually pinned rather firmly to the lattice axes. And so it's not really free to adjust. If you're talking about helium 3, superfluid helium 3, where again the order parameter is believed to have an interesting internal structure, then it would be rather different, because there the anisotropy can just sort of wander about as it wants to. But in a crystal, not usually true. So crudely speaking, the answer to your question is yes, you can use Ginzburg-Landau with a few caveats. So that's the heavy fermions then. Let's go on to the next material, which is strontium ruthenate. And one thing which is interesting about strontium ruthenate is, at least as far as we know right now, it appears to be unique in its class. There are related compounds. In particular, you can have a two-layer version of strontium ruthenate, but it behaves quite differently. It has very interesting magnetic properties, but it apparently is not superconducting. The strontium ruthenate, the original motivation, I think, to investigate it was that it's isostructural to the cuprate. When we come to the cuprates, we'll see they have very, very distinctive character. They have a set of copper oxide planes interspersed by other kinds of material. And basically, the structure of strontium ruthenate can be obtained from the cuprate simply by replacing the copper by ruthenium and the calcium by strontium. However, the chemistry is actually quite different. If you actually count the electrons which go with these different elements, you find they're quite different in the two cases. There's no obvious immediate relation to the cuprates. Moreover, the normal state properties appear quite dissimilar. In fact, below about 25 K, the strontium ruthenate appears to behave pretty much like a strongly anisotropic Fermi liquid. That's very different, as we'll see, from the case of the cuprates. The specific heat, crudely speaking, looks like this, which is the standard textbook form, this being the phonon contribution, this being the electronic contribution. The Pauli spin susceptibility, roughly constant, again, as expected. Resistivity goes as a constant, plus BT squared. that both in the AB plane and along the C-axis, and that's characteristic of coherent block wave transport, which is limited first by impurities, that gives the A, and then by electron-electron umklapp scattering, which gives the T-squared. Again, standard textbook stuff. The in-plane resistivity is of the order of 1 microcentimeter. It's quite decent metallic conductivity. That implies that at least some of the samples are very pure. It can be. It's interesting that this material can be made very pure. So just here's just a view of the lattice. If you look from the side, you have these ruthenium oxide planes, analogous to the copper oxide planes and the cuprates. And between them, you have the these spacing elements, in this case, strontium and oxygen. For a top, if you look down from the top, what you see is something more like this. You see the ruthenium's at the corners of the lattice and the oxygen's at the midpoints. Yeah. Again, exactly as you'd see in the cuprates. Okay. However, one thing that is in common, besides the structure with the cuprates, is the anisotropy of the normal state properties. The resistivity is anisotropic by a factor of the order of 10 to the 3, which is quite comparable to what it is in the cuprates. Now, as to band structure, by and large, the exotic superconductors can be divided into those in which it's very easy to infer a band structure, for example, from quantum oscillation data, and then compare it with theory, and those in which it turns out to be very, very, very hard to do that. And like the organics, strontium ruthenate falls in the first class. So it turns out that you can make it sufficiently pure that you can actually do rather nice quantum oscillation effects. De Haussmann alpha and Shubnikov de Haas, etc. And moreover, you can try to do band theory. I mean, the band theorists always try to do band theory, whether it works or not. But in this case, it does look like it seems to work. And the Fermi surface consists of three strongly two-dimensional sheets. So if you look at the C-axis behavior, it's very barrel-like. It's very characteristic of strongly two-dimensional behavior. Very little depends on the momentum in this direction. Bit of detail here. There are three different sheets, one hole-like and two electron-like, and the Fermi wave vectors are small, but not that small. So that's the size of your Fermi surface, basically. The effective masses. Relative to the free electron mass, rather large. But if you now compare the effective masses with the band masses, they're not so large. They're still rather large. So that's usually thought to be an indication of strong correlations, as it is in the heavy fermion systems. But remember that the effective masses here are nothing like what they are in the heavy fermion systems. Okay, what does one know about the superconducting state? Well, one very important piece of information is that apparently whatever the direction you measure it in, chi does appear to be constant in the superconducting state, at least at the lowest fields at which you can measure it. And that then is rather strong indication of a triplet ESP state. Okay. Okay, suppose that the order parameter is indeed of ESP form, then you can always find a set of axes, at least one, maybe more than one, in which you can write the spin wave function in this form here. And then it has to be multiplied by an odd parity or orbital function. So that raises the crucial question, what is the orbital wave function of the Cooper pairs in strontium ruthenate? Well, we have strong a priori reasons to believe that it's odd parity. And there's a set of experiments from Penn State University, Yig Liu and collaborators, which look at the Josephson effect in circuits of strontium ruthenate and conclude rather firmly that it is indeed odd parity. But that still leaves open the question, is the order parameter real? for example, f of k just goes like kx, or is it complex, kx plus ky? Actually, this should be referring to here. So that if you did have an order parameter of this type, that would break time reversal invariance. It would indicate in some sense, a finite relative angular momentum of your pairs. Now, a priori, in BCS theory, you would like the square of the order parameter to be as uniform as possible over the Fermi surface, and that would mean that kx plus iky would be always favored. However, you can't necessarily conclude that in the case of a crystal. Crystalline lattice effects might favor simply a real order parameter. So one doesn't know a priori which of these two is going to happen. However, there is by now a fair number of experiments which seem to point towards the violation of time reversal invariance. First of all, the earliest data, that muon spin rotation experiments seem to indicate that an extra internal magnetic field developed in the superconducting state. What is really rather puzzling is that if you actually look at the raw data, and this is not often emphasized, but if you look at the raw data, that magnetic field is not apparently in the direction you would think it ought to be, which is normal to the planes. It does appear to be a non-zero transverse component. So that's puzzling. Second point is...
So what is muon spin rotation?
What's muon spin rotation? Okay, so if you take a beam of, let us say, positive muons, which you've got out of some accelerator, you fire them at a solid. What happens is that the muon, first of all, rather rapidly, it tends to get trapped some side or another, then it sits there, and it lasts for what is it? I think if I remember, the lifetime of the muon is something of the order of a microsecond. It's a long time by solid state standards. And you, while it's sitting there, if there's an external magnetic field, or in fact if there's any kind of magnetic field, the spin will precess. Now, and then when the muon decays, it will decay into an electron, a muon neutrino, an electron antineutrino, I guess, and you actually, of course, and in principle, you can see the... what you can actually see most easily is the direction in which the electron is emitted. And we have a rather good theory of the beta decay, and so we can now correlate that direction with the direction of the muon spin. That's the famous parity maximal parity violation effect. And so you can actually tell how far the muon has precessed in the time it took to decay. And then by doing a bit of massaging of the data, you can actually figure out what the effective field was that the muon was seeing. Okay? So it's generally believed that muon spin rotation is a rather nice way to measure the distribution of magnetic fields inside a solid. There is some non-trivial theory which goes into that, but people usually think it's fairly reliable. So what you see in this case is that even when you have zero external magnetic field, nevertheless the muon does appear to persist. So the muon does appear to persist, even though there's no external magnetic field. So it looks like there has been an internal one generated. My colleague, the second piece of evidence is from my colleague Delvin Harlingen at Illinois. He's done a lot of experiments on the magnetic field dependence and telegraph noise in the critical current of Jezzer junctions, and a rather natural interpretation of that is the idea that you do have domains forming, but you see, you could as well have px minus ipy as px plus ipy, since this is a spontaneous breaking of time reversal invariance, and so the idea is that you get these domains forming and then switching and so forth. And it's a consistent interpretation of the data. I don't think one can say it's totally unique. And so I think the evidence on the whole is in favor of a spontaneous breaking of time reversal invariance, but there is one problem with that. If you had an ideal px plus ipy state, that is, if the order parameter were really exactly this without modification, then certainly that is going to have no nodes. So, as I say, an ideal state of this type certainly should have no nodes. There is a problem in that that would mean that you have an exponentially small number of quasar particles, just as you do in the BCS state, from low temperatures. And therefore, you'd have no appreciable contribution to things like specific heat, the thermal conductivity, nuclear spin relaxation time. Well, alas, in real life, you do seem to have considerable evidence for a power law contribution. So that would appear to indicate that at least part of the gap has nodes. So that's a puzzle. At this point, however, one might want to bear in mind a feature which is also we're also going to see is important in the ferropneumatite materials, namely that you actually have not a single band intersecting the Fermi surface, but you have several, and it's entirely possible that although the symmetry of the gap is the same on these various Fermi surfaces, the actual detailed properties, for example, whether it has nodes or not, might actually be different. So I think that's one possible let out there. Now, in principle, there ought to be a critical test. If you really believe that it's kx plus iky, then you what you would predict, and I'm not going to try to go through the theory for this, but it's similar to what we saw earlier for these Josephson experiments. If you did an experiment similar to what my colleague Dale van Harlingen did for the cuprates, where you take a circuit made partly out of strontium ruthenate and partly out of aluminum, and you apply a flux through the center here, then the critical current of this device should have a maximum at phi equals a quarter or three quarters of a flux quantum. And that would be very striking, very significant. And I'm a little surprised that, as far as I know, Ying Liu and others haven't actually yet tried to do that experiment. I think it would be significant. It would be done. Okay, I think that probably concludes what I wanted to say about strontium ruthenate. Yeah, so I say almost certainly spin triplet, therefore presumably odd parity, and everything seems to be consistent with that. Time reversal broken, probably, but we can't really, I think, say for the 100% confidence that it's broken yet. There are some other experiments, including a very recent one by my colleague Rafi Badakian at Illinois, which seem to further support the idea that you have a breaking of time reversal invariance. That's not correct. What that supports is that you have two independent spin populations. Doesn't say anything directly about time reversal invariance. Let's go on now to the rather interesting recent class of materials, the ferropneumatites. Now, caution, these were only discovered, to be superconducting, in 2008. So there hasn't been a lot of time. And judging by the history of the cuprates, some of the experimental data which comes out in the first few years may not be all that reliable. So we have to remember that. Now, as to the composition of the ferropneumatites, life is actually quite complicated. Originally, there were, in the first 2 years or so, there were two major groups, and each of them contained a transition metal, which is usually iron, and a pneumatite. Pneumatite is an element in the nitrogen column of the periodic table, and generally that was arsenic, although sometimes you get phosphorus elements. And originally there were two main classes of parent compound, the so-called 1111s, which had one rare earth, one transition metal element, one pneumatite and oxygen. Example is lanthanum, rare earth, or pseudo-rare earth, iron for the transition metal, arsenic for the pneumatite. And then it turns out actually this material as it stands is not superconducting, but if you replace a little bit of the oxygen with fluorine and thereby change the valencies, you do get superconductivity. Second class is the so-called 122s. There you have an alkaline earth, two transition metals, two nictides. A typical example is barium for the alkaline earth, iron for the transition metal, arsenic for the nictide. In the last 2 years or so, it's become clear that there are actually even more compounds than that. The so-called 111s, lithium, iron, arsenide, even 11s which don't even have any arsenic in them, but have selenium instead. So the class of ferropenictides is actually quite complicated. Turns out it's rather easier to prepare the 122s in large single crystals, and therefore most of the work, experimental work, has been done on this. In the first year or so, the work was almost exclusively on this class of compounds, but now most of it switched to the 122s. Here's a schematic diagram of the structure of the 111s. You have basically two layers. This is the iron arsenide layer here. See, so the iron is there, the arsenides are outside there. And then you have the lanthanum oxide layers separating the two. So it's obvious this is a fairly strongly layered structure. In the parent compound, the valence state is probably this. In other words, all the shells are essentially closed. However, if you substitute iron for the fluorine, if you substitute fluorine for the oxygen, then it looks as if the extra electron migrates to the iron arsenide level layer, as we'll see happens also in the case of the cuprates. So, for example, if I have this kind of compound with X of the order of 0.1, which is a typical value for superconductivity, turns out the carrier density is something like, the extra carrier density is something like 10 to the 21 electrons per cubic centimeter. Turns out, interestingly, that's quite comparable to the cuprates, and even the density in plane is somewhat comparable to the cuprates. Interesting point is that just as in the cuprates, and also incidentally in the alkali fluorides, the charge reservoir, in this case it's the fluorines and the which have replaced the oxygen in the lanthanum oxide layer, this reservoir is well separated from the metallic layer here, and we'll see later that I think this is really a rather common element in many of the high-temperature superconducting materials. You get the 111s are electron-doped, but the 122s are hole-doped. Nevertheless, they seem to behave qualitatively in rather similar ways. Yep.
In manufacturing these crystals, do they have to layer them by hand effectively, or is it
As far as I understand it, yes, the latter. That is, you throw them all together with, of course, sufficient care and annealing and so forth, and the crystal does form spontaneously. These are not MBE manufactured. At least that's my understanding, and I'm fairly sure that is correct. Okay, so here we have our phase diagram. Again, you may recognize, if you know about the cuprates, you may recognize it as being rather similar to the phase diagram of the cuprates. Difference is that on this side of the diagram, that is for low doping, you've got antiferromagnetism, but it is metallic. So it's like metallic chromium, something like that. Sometimes you get this phase diagram, which is almost exactly similar to the cuprates. Sometimes you get this and with a first order phase transition there. The maximum is something like 0. At values of doping about 0.12 to 0.15, but it's very shallow compared to the cuprates. In other words, the variation with doping is much less than it is with the cuprates. Now, as to the absolute value, I should say that as in the case also of the cuprates, the discussion of the experimental properties is complicated by the fact that we have this rather complicated phase diagram here. And moreover, you get a crystallographic transition occurring at a particular point in the phase diagram very often. So this is a slightly oversimplified account, but crudely speaking, we find a specific heat, the linear term, and a cubic term. Again, standard textbook result, phonons, electrons. Chi, not quite so standard. There is a constant, which is the textbook result, but you also get a term linear in T, which is not entirely negligible. The DC conductivity, roughly A plus BT squared. So again, more or less standard result. In plane, as far as we know, okay, we have to be a little careful about this, but as far as we know, in plane conductivity, roughly the same, of the same order of magnitude at room temperature as that of the cuprates, 3 milliohms. Now, one question is the anisotropy of the conductivity, and at least when I last looked, apparently that hadn't been measured. And I think I'm not quite sure what the reason for that is. I would have thought it was a rather obvious measurement to try to make, but I guess even now, even though they can make rather good crystals of 1-2-2, they haven't been able to orient them to the point where they can easily measure that. That's a pity, because one would actually like to know how anisotropic these materials are. As the Hall coefficient, well, again, A plus BT, rather reminiscent of what happens in the cuprates. But overall, the general picture is looking somewhat textbook-like, with the qualification that indeed you have to worry about the onset of antiferromagnetism and so forth in various parts of the phase diagram. As to the band structure, again, it turns out that you can actually do both quantum oscillation and ARPES, angular resolved photo emission experiments to try to determine that, and you could also do LDA calculations, and they seem to agree reasonably well. It turns out you have in total 5 bands in this case, of which some are electron-like, some are hole-like. All of these bands appear to be rather strongly two-dimensional. So again, you have a rather barrel-like form along the C-axis. On to the superconducting properties. Okay, so you asked about the transition temperature. I think the record in the 1111 compounds is still 56K, roughly. I doubt whether that's eventually going to turn out to be the absolute maximum. People are getting better and better at making these crystals and so forth, and I bet it will go at least up to 60, if not beyond that. In the 1-2-2s, somewhat lower, about 38K. In the 1-1s, as high as 20K. It's weakly dependent on doping, much weaker. Dependence on doping is much weaker than in the cuprates. The fact that you have such a strong and such a high transition temperature is a surprise, because all the standard law until quite recently was that any kind of magnetism, and in particular the existence of local magnetic moments, would be rather strongly deleterious to superconductivity. You remember that there's this very well-known result, deleterious, harmful to superconductivity. You remember this in the classic BCS superconductors, there's this standard result that even a very small amount of magnetic impurity will tend to drive the transition temperature to zero. So it's quite surprising that in this case, where you've got basically magnetic moment, one magnetic moment per crystal lattice site, you've still got a reasonably high temperature superconductivity. Discuss now the experimental properties in the S-state. All the ferropnictides are strongly type 2 with an extrapolated HC2, which is something like 55 Tesla. That's getting comparable to what it is for the cuprates. The anisotropy is relatively small. That's the anisotropy now, not of the resistivity directly, but of the of HC2. So, which is maybe indicative that that would suggest that the resistivity anisotropy is also rather small. The penetration depths, a couple of thousand angstroms, what a fairly typical value for the exotic superconductors. The in-plane pair radius, something like 20 angstroms. So again, you see, this much smaller than this, this means you are strongly type 2. Now, very interestingly, R pairs seems to show, angular resolved photo emission, seems to show that on all sheets, the gap is only weakly k-dependent. So that would, if that were really true, you would expect that the gap is only weakly k-dependent, then it doesn't have any nodes. You'd expect that the density of normal quasar particles falls off exponentially at low temperatures. Unless, however, nothing is ever straightforward in these systems, the NMR and penetration depth will appear to be mutually inconsistent, but both of them do seem to favor a power law dependence, low temperatures. So again, that's a bit of a puzzle. How can it be that the gap appears to be only weakly k-dependent? So in other words, it's essentially non-zero everywhere on all your Fermi surfaces, and nevertheless, you're getting these power laws. Well, a very important piece of information is that the night shift does seem to go to zero for all directions of the magnetic field in the limit that the temperature goes to zero. So that then rather strongly suggests that you have a spin singlet state. Isotope effect. The experiments, again, they have been over the last 4 years not entirely consistent. Most recent experiments do seem to be giving a rather small value of alpha. And that therefore, does suggest that the mechanism is mostly non-phonon. So I think the fact that the isotope coefficient, the isotope exponent is nearly zero is a relief to the theorists, because I think even with all the sort of complications which arose with the appearance of, say, magnesium diboride and the alkali fullerides, theorists who work on these things do are prepared to, I think, take a large bet that a phonon mechanism could not give you a transition temperature as high as 55K. And 40K is sort of pushing it, but 55K is really a bit too high. So they say. I have to just listen to what they say. So that seems consistent. It does look as if the mechanism is mostly electronic. Okay. So what is the pairing state? Can we say anything about that? The night shift does suggest a spin singlet. So for approximately tetragonal symmetry, if you have a spin singlet case, then we may or may not see this in more detail in the case of the cuprates, but there are four candidates, of which for various reasons two are thought to be especially likely. And these are the so-called the pure S state, which is presumably nodeless, and the dx squared minus y squared state, which has nodes at pi pi. Now, unfortunately, you see, now we have a contradiction, as I mentioned before. The R-pairs data suggests that you don't have any nodes, whereas in other words, it's S state. The nuclear spin relaxation and the penetration depth rather favor nodes. Yep. Now, alas, there's yet one more complication. And I think this is the first time this has really been sort of emphasized or much appreciated in the case of exotic superconductivity. If you've got several different bands crossing your Fermi surface, then you have to be careful about the structure of the gap. What is true, what must remain true, is that, barring pathology, as it were, the gap has to transform according, all the gaps, all the order parameters, have to transform according to the same representation of the symmetry group. So if it's s on one band, it has to be s on the other two bands. If it's dx squared in one band, it has to be dx squared minus y squared on the other two. I think we'll make that statement fairly firmly. However, there's an additional question. Does the gap change sign going from one band to another? And that's actually a rather tricky question. At first sight, it's rather tempting to think that that question has to be physically meaningless because you would always redefine the phase of your block wave states to eliminate any sign change. But if you think about it carefully, that's not true, in fact. The question, does the gap actually change sign as I go from one band to the other, does actually have some physical sense. And in fact, it turns out that a theory based on the spin fluctuation mechanism, which is in some sense the most obvious non-phonon mechanism, predicts that the gap changes sign between the electron-like and hole-like sheets. That's the so-called S plus minus state. Now, as so often happens in these matters, the theorists made this prediction, and the experimentalists rushed off and promptly came up with results which they claimed bore this prediction out. There are a number of experiments, but they're all rather indirect. There's a Josephson-like experiment on a polycrystalline sample which shows half-flux quanta, and it has been suggested that... Sorry, let me try to go back to where I was. Yep. It has been suggested that supports the S plus minus state, but I think the argument is really rather indirect. And there have been some STM experiments, again, which claim to have supported that assignment. But I think, quite frankly, right now, the belief that it is S plus minus is mainly based on theoretical considerations, not on direct experimental evidence. Now, if you could do an experiment similar to what my colleague Dove and Harlingen did on the cuprates, what you would be able to tell is whether it's S or dx squared minus y squared. I do not believe myself that you'd be able to tell, or not be able to tell easily from those experiments, whether the gap changes sign between the different bands. There have been other proposals for ways to test that. Again, they're rather indirect, and so far, as far as I know, the experiments have not been performed. So things are a bit up in the air in this case. Okay, so I think that's probably what I wanted to say, yes, about the ferronictides. I have at this point a choice, I guess. I could try to finish off this whole subject by going through the cuprates rather fast. Alternatively, we could start to go through the cuprates more slowly, and I could spend also the next lecture talking a bit about generically about these exotic superconductors. Okay, so let's go on then to start discussing the properties of the cuprates. But as I say, I won't attempt to get those finished today because we will have time to do that next time. Okay, so the cuprates really are the exotic superconductors par excellence. They're the only group of materials which, to date, show reproducible superconductivity above 100K. Now, not all materials which chemically are cuprates are superconductors, and I'll come back to that point later. But there are more than 300 different chemical compounds in the cuprate class which are superconductors, and many of them have TCs way up in the range of 110, 120K. And you have to remember, I mean, when looking at the significance of that figure, you have to remember that in the summer of 1986, the maximum transition temperature realized in any material was 25K. So we've gone up by a factor of five. The composition of the cuprates, well, there is a standard chemical notation, which is the one which is used in most of the literature. I personally think that it's very unnatural, and that there's a much more natural notation which ideally should be used, which I propose to use when possible. This is that a cuprate consists of N copper CuO2 groups, N minus 1 so-called spaces, or rather intercalants, and some charged reservoir group X. In the, here, A is an alkaline earth, or it may, in some cases, be replaced by a rare earth, yttrium or lanthanum. X is a combination of elements, always including oxygen, that's the charged reservoir, there, so-called. So, for example, if you take YbCO, a famous sort of standard high-temperature superconductor, then that has N equals 2, so two copper oxide groups per unit cell. A is yttrium in that case, and the charged reservoir group is this stuff here. Why is that a natural notation? Well, because of the structure. If you look at the cuprates from the side, what you see is one or more copper oxide planes, and viewed from above, this is what the copper oxide planes look like. So you have the coppers sitting on the corners of a square lattice, the oxygen sitting in the middle of the sides. So you can easily count that there are twice as many oxygens as there are coppers here. If I had more than one copper oxide plane per unit cell, there will be intercalants which sit, in fact, in the middle of this, but they're between the two planes here. So in this particular case, in the case of YbCO, the intercalant is yttrium. And then you have all this charged reservoir stuff which sits between the copper oxide planes. An interesting phenomenon in the case of the cuprates is the so-called homologous series. These are sequences which differ only in having a different number of copper oxide planes per unit cell. So, for example, I can start off with this compound, which has one copper oxide plane per unit cell. Then I'll go on to this one, which has two, this one has three, etc., etc. But all the rest, I slightly misdrew this, because really the space here should be the same in all cases. I've simply expanded the whole thing. Okay, let's look at the valence considerations. If you have a given charged reservoir constituent, you can start with the stoichiometric compound, often called the parent compound, where the valence is exactly balanced. For example, lanthanum copper oxide, the parent compound, has closed shells of lanthanum and oxygen. Yttrium has this configuration here. So in both cases, apart from the copper, you've basically got closed shells. But the copper is special. The in-plane copper started off, you remember, with this is the sort of atomic physics textbook configuration of copper, 3d10, 4s1. It's lost two electrons, so it's now in the 3d9 configuration. In other words, you can say it has one hole in the d shell per formula unit. And therefore, naively, such a compound should be a metal. But it turns out, in fact, in the case of lanthanum, of these two parent compounds, it's not a metal. It's actually a so-called antiferromagnetic Mott insulator. In other words, you have electrons strongly localized on the coppers, or approximately on the coppers, and they order themselves antiferromagnetically. And it looks, everything we know from, for example, neutron scattering, etc., does seem to conform to that picture. So there's no great mystery about the parent compounds, apparently. Suppose now you start to dope it. That is, you start with a parent compound, say this one, and in a fraction X of the unit cells, you replace the lanthanum with strontium. So you've now got this compound. Well, lanthanum has valence 3+, strontium is 2+. So the effect is to add minus X electrons, that is X holes, per formula unit. And in this particular case, there's really nowhere for those holes to go but the copper oxide planes. We'll see in other compounds there may be other possibilities, but in this case, they can really only go to the copper oxide planes. So we can be fairly confident that the doping per copper oxide unit above the parent compound, P, is the same as X. Now, this is an important concept. More generally, even in more complicated cases, we're going to want to work in terms of this doping per copper oxide unit. We'll always call that P. It may or may not be the same as X, as we'll see. But in this case, it is. An alternative way of doping lanthanum copper oxide is to add delta oxygens per formula unit. So then you get this compound here. But in this case, since the valence of oxygen is 2-, the effect is to add 2 delta holes per copper oxide unit. That is, P equals 2 delta. Now, in multiplane materials, you have to remember that any added holes have to be shared between the n planes per unit cell. And therefore, for example, for, this would be barium, yttrium barium copper oxide, we expect P to be a half of the number of number of holes generated, which is 2 delta, so we expect P equals delta. But unless, in this case, there are other complications because the added holes can go elsewhere than the copper oxide planes. In fact, in yttrium barium copper oxide, there are also chains, and the electrons can migrate there. What about the orbitals occupied by these holes? Both the one hole, you remember you already had one hole per copper oxide unit already there in the parent state, and now you have some added holes, and all of those are believed to occupy an orbital which is mostly the 3d x squared minus y squared atomic orbital. Remember, despite the notation here, this has nothing to do with superconductivity. We're just writing down the standard notation for an atomic state here. So they're believed to occupy that orbital, but this orbital is somewhat hybridized with the p's on the neighboring oxygens. So you've got basically a copper sitting there, 4 oxygens sitting out there, and you get this kind of hybridized orbital forming. Okay, the vast majority of cuprate superconductors are hole-doped, but there are very few that are electron-doped, and the best known is neodymium-cerium copper oxide. All the odds are that the properties of the electron-doped materials are at least qualitatively similar to the hole-doped ones. That was not obvious a priori, but it does seem to be true experimentally. How are we going to try to construct a phase diagram for the cuprates? What we'd like to do, ideally, is to construct a generic phase diagram for the cuprates in terms of the two main variables, which are the temperature and the number of holes per copper oxide unit. And the problem, really, is that there is no single material in which the whole range of P is explored for various reasons. You get all sorts of chemical instabilities coming in at one point or another. So what you usually do is the following. In cases where all the added holes are known with fair confidence to go to the copper oxide planes, for example, lanthanum strontium copper oxide, you fix P from X or delta or whatever. In the cases where the destination of the added holes is ambiguous, you fix P so that where the accessible region overlaps this case A, then the P dependence is consistent between the two. However, one should bear in mind that is an assumption. It's an assumption which appears to give you a consistent phase diagram, but it is an assumption. So let's see what happens if you do that. So now here is the famous phase diagram of the cuprates. I say this is not necessarily everything that people will usually draw, but this is all that can be inferred quite directly from experiment. So So what you have is the temperature up this axis, doping along this axis. As I say, when you have a doping zero, this is the parent compound. This is, with fair confidence, known to be a nice antiferromagnetic mod insulator. As I start to dope, initially the antiferromagnetism remains. You get a certain amount of disorder occurring, but there is still a residual antiferromagnetism. And that goes away by a second order phase transition, and it goes away at just about doping 0.04 here. Now this is very interesting, tiny region between the disappearance of antiferromagnetism and the onset of superconductivity here. This is rather little explored experimentally. It's rather difficult to access. But it does appear that there is a finite gap here. Again, that may or may not be theoretically significant. Then you get the superconducting phase formed. And what is interesting is that it looks as if it's consistent, at least, to assume that for all compounds, the dependence on the doping P is the same, except for the actual absolute scale up here. In other words, the shape of the curve is always of this form here. Right? As I say, we don't really know that quite directly, but everything is consistent, at least, with that formula. However, the actual scale of the curve, that is the value of TC maximum, that is varies enormously from one compound to another. For example, for bismuth 2201 under normal conditions, this is only 10K. For mercury 2223 under 20 gigapascals of pressure, goes way up to more than half of room temperature. There's a huge range here. So it's rather remarkable that the doping, as far as we know at least, the doping dependence always seems to be the same, but the temperature scale is quite different. Okay, let's see. I just have time to cover this. This was a question which someone asked. Determinants of TC other than doping. Well, people have speculated a lot about what controls this. It's very, very, it's a very noticeable difference between different cuprates, so it's an obvious question. What's behind this? And people have tried to make correlations with the degree of orthorhombic anisotropy, the degree of buckling of the planes, the distance of the apical oxygens from the central plane, chemical environment of the planes, dot, dot, dot. You can make these correlations, but then you can make any other, and it doesn't look as if anyone overwhelmingly wins out. However, there's one thing which is really very, very striking. In the homologous series, there's a very universal dependence of the maximum transition temperature on the number of copper oxide planes per unit cell. And it's this. So here is the table of this. You see that in all these homologous series, the five different ones, TC always goes up from n equals 1 to n equals 2. It always goes up again from n equals 2 to n equals 3, and then, generally speaking, it goes down again. Now, I think one should be careful. One probably shouldn't take these numbers too seriously for the following reason. In the cases, we certainly know that in the cases of n equals 1, 2, or 3, you've got to attain a certain value of doping in order to get your maximum TC. Now, that means you've got to pull off from your charged reservoir a certain number of electrons. But the more planes you have, the more electrons you have to pull off. Eventually, the charged reservoir is going to run out of electrons. So it could conceivably be that in these cases, it's simply that you haven't been able to attain the optimal doping, as it were. As I say, I think there has to be some experimental work on this, but it's not widely known. And now, there's one interesting case in this respect. There is one compound, the so-called infinite layer compound, where you have nothing but copper oxide planes and intercalants. You have no charged reservoir layer. Interestingly, at least so far, that has not shown a very high transition temperature. It's only about 120 or so, 110, 120, so, which is not terribly high for a cuprate. Okay. Just one final remark. The dogs which did not bark in the night time, these are what I call the class of cuprates, which whatever you do to it can never be made superconducting. You know, people have tried doping it, they've tried applying magnetic fields, putting on pressure, never becomes superconducting. What's little noticed, I think, in the literature is that without exception, all of these are bi- or trilayer compounds with an alkaline earth spacer heavier than calcium. And I think one plausible explanation of what's going on there is that when you substitute, you've got your calcium sitting there keeping your two layers apart, right? When you take out the calcium and put in, say, strontium is just that little bit bigger than the calcium, so it pushes the layers apart slightly. Thereupon, what's liable to happen is that you get so-called intruder oxygens sneaking in between the layers, and it's actually been found experimentally in one experiment that TC is correlated not to the amount of strontium but to the amount of oxygen that's snuck in. So I think it's those oxygens which are doing the damage. And in fact, a few years ago, I suggested to my colleague Jim Eckstein at Illinois that he try to make one of these so-called non-superconducting bilayer compounds, And, well, I don't know if he tried especially hard to keep the oxygen out, but he, I think he succeeded, because this is the first example known of any a bilayer compound spaced with strontium, which is actually a high-temperature superconductor. So that's still a bit of a mystery, but it's an interesting fact. So I think probably this is the point at which, okay, we could go on, but I think we've run out of our time. So let me continue then. Let me start the next lecture by continuing the discussion of the cuprates and some of their major experimental properties, and then I'll spend the rest of the next lecture talking rather informally about some of my own, some general questions which other people have discussed, some questions which I'm particularly interested in.